Beneath St Boniface Down lays a Cold War nuclear bunker. This secret underground structure has remained undisturbed for many years, with almost all trace of the site above ground having long been demolished or removed. The bunker has been sealed and buried since the early 90s. In 2008, a small group of unnamed explorers managed to regain entry into the site. However, shortly after the news of this was made public, the entrance was quickly filled in, capped and buried, seemingly sealing the underground bunker permanently. Having never had the chance to explore, in the years following, I, like many, searched around the surrounding area, hoping to discover another way in. In early 2016, I was informed of a couple of people working on a potential lead. The plan to find a way in was certainly plausible, but it was also hugely ambitious. Because of this, doubtful that they'd be successful, I put it out of my mind. Several months passed, and then late one evening I received a tip-off. The Ventnor R1 bunker had been cracked again. RAF Ventnor was one of the original 20 chain home radar stations commissioned in 1938. Chain home was the code name for a network of early warning radar systems, and it comprised of a series of linked coastal radar stations that extended the entire length of the country. The chain home was designed to provide early warning from an approaching threat from the German Luftwaffe, and it became operational just in time for the Battle of Britain. In 1939, the Germans became suspicious of the construction of large towers along the coast of Britain and began secretly monitoring the output from the masts. Fortunately for Britain, the Germans were unable to identify the true purpose of the radar frequencies and dismissed the idea of Britain having an operational radar defence system. Despite perhaps not knowing the full purpose of chain home stations, RAF Ventnor was attacked twice by German bombers during August of 1940. The first attack only resulted in minimal damage, with reports of the station being back operational within an hour. The second attack caused significantly more damage to the surface buildings and resulted in the station being taken offline. The station was put out of operation for a couple of months, and as a contingency measure for future outages, a permanent reserve station was built in St. Lawrence. Chain home stations played a crucial role during the war. Germany planned to bomb Britain into submission with the might of the Luftwaffe, who had been instrumental in the success across much of mainland Europe. Chain home enabled aircraft to be scrambled directly to an incoming enemy attack, giving the perception that Britain had many more resources and was much stronger than it actually was. Failure to overwhelm the RAF forced Germany to cancel a planned amphibious invasion of Britain called Operation Sea Lion. This inability to destroy Britain's air defences was a crucial turning point during the war. RAF Ventnor continued to play a key role up until the end of World War II. The station was used to monitor V-2 rockets launched across the Channel and assisted in the formation of the D-Day invasion craft. On the 20th of November in 1947, a newspaper plane heading to the Channel Island, Jersey, struck one of the receiver masts, killing both crew members. At the end of the war, RAF Ventnor was put into care and maintenance, and in 1957, the remaining chain home radar masts were removed. Following the successful 1949 Soviet atom bomb testing, Britain was once again perceived as vulnerable from air attack. A new countrywide air defence plan was urgently launched called the Rehabilitation of the Old Radars Programme. In order to get the rotor programme operational as soon as possible, the first phase called for 28 of the original World War II chain home stations to be brought back into commission as a stopgap. Ventnor was also selected to take part in phase 2 of the programme and would house a new centimetric early warning radar. This new radar system needed to be situated at least 100 feet above sea level, whilst also being located relatively close to the coast. This made RAF Ventnor an ideal location, as the high position of the station enabled the radar to have an uninterrupted sweep of the coast. A large underground operations room was also constructed to protect the radio operators and monitoring equipment. The entrance for this new underground bunker was hidden beneath a guardhouse disguised as a bungalow. Inside of the bungalow was a vertical shaft which led down to a long incline passageway. Rotor bunkers were built to a uniform specification based on the type of radar used at the site. Ventnor was built to the R1 specification. It was a single level structure situated approximately 40 feet below the ground and heavily armoured by up to 12 feet of thick reinforced concrete. To the left of the entrance corridor is a gated transformer room. Opposite the transformer room, on the right of the corridor, is a small ladder. The ladder leads up to a pair of shafts where cables from the radars above ground would have been run into the operations room below. You can see here the ladder up to the surface entrance, which has been capped with concrete. At the end of the entrance corridor is a set of blast doors. These doors would have been the final protective barrier of the bunker. Each door is made from reinforced tank steel and weighs approximately 1.5 tons. The bunker was designed to withstand near miss from the largest known conventional bombs of the time, although it was never designed to survive a direct hit from a nuclear weapon. Construction of the bunker was a significant undertaking, and work began in February of 1952 to first dig out a very large 60 feet deep hole. The island didn't have the resources or a large enough skilled workforce to build such a structure. Because of this, many of the materials and heavy machinery were barged over from the mainland. Around 120 Irish labourers were brought across to help with the excavation and construction of the bunker. During its construction, up to 200 men would work on site, with as many as 100 lorry loads transporting materials required up and down the steep narrow roads to the site. The first room on the left leads through to what would have been the radar office. The suspended wooden floor in this section of the bunker is extremely soft underfoot, so you need to be extra careful not to fall through. This room would have been filled with rows of radar equipment. You can make out the faint outline of the Isle of Wight on this window, and here we have a tally board where casualties and damage of a local attack could be logged. This is the operations room. To the right is a ladder that leads down to a pit where the radar plotting projector would have been housed, but unfortunately this is now completely flooded out. Construction of the underground control centre was completed in November of 1952, but the new Type 80 radar that the rotor bunker was designed for wasn't handed over to the site until March of 1956. Due to this significant delay, the radar was only operational for a short 2 to 3 year period. By this point, intercontinental ballistic missiles capable of carrying a nuclear payload had been developed. These missiles flew too high to be detected by the Type 80 radar, and radar technology itself had moved on, making the site redundant. We're now leading through to the plant room. It doesn't have the false floors or ceilings of the other rooms, and this is so it could accommodate all the cabling and large air conditioning equipment required for maintaining the bunker. The RAF left the site in 1961, and the station was taken over by the Ministry of Aviation and used as a radar and communication station for the Civil Aviation Authority. The Civil Aviation Authority didn't need the R1 bunker, and in 1962 it was refurbished and leased to the Isle of Wight Council. The council repurposed the R1 bunker to be used as a county control centre from where the island's emergency services would have been administered in the event of a nuclear attack. The control centre would have been staffed with people from within the council and service providing organisations. The bunker staff would have been tasked with looking after casualties, coordinating food supplies, housing the homeless, and maintaining law and order. The bunker remained operational in this capacity up until the end of the Cold War in 1991. Towards the back of the bunker is a second set of blast doors, which lead through to the main air intake ventilation shaft and up to the emergency exit. On the left of the emergency exit corridor is a gated room which houses the air washing system. In the event of nuclear fallout, this system would draw in and filter the air from above. On the right of the corridor is the pump room and sewage extractor. The sump is partially flooded, but you can just about make out the pumps below the water level. The emergency exit is located up 7 flights of steel stairs. The emergency exit hatch was the point of entry for the explorers who gained entry back in 2008, and after its discovery this was filled in with rubble, which you can see here. When the council ceased operations, the bunker was handed back to the Civil Aviation Authority, who decided they had no further use for it. The guardhouse, air vents and emergency exit tower were all demolished, the cable shafts capped with concrete and buried, leaving no trace of the site above ground. It's a massive shame that such an interesting and historically important part of the island's past has ended up in this neglected and forgotten state. I was lucky enough to be able to visit the site a couple of times between 2016 and 2017. Even within that relatively short period of time, the bunker had noticeably deteriorated further. It looks as though the bunker has been leaking for a number of years, which has resulted in it slowly filling up. This incredibly damp environment makes walking across the suspended wooden floors very dangerous.
I'm okay.
They've either bowed out or rotted to the point of giving way underfoot. Most of the bunker is coated in a build-up of mould, and the doors and most of the remaining fixtures are extremely brittle. Despite the current condition of the bunker, when compared to other R1 sites across the country, Ventnor doesn't seem to be in too bad of a condition. Although I think it's very unlikely that someone would come forward with the level of investment required to prevent the bunker falling into further disrepair. However, just pumping out some of the excess water would go a long way to somewhat preserving the site for the future. For more information on the Ventnor bunker, I would highly recommend checking out the Ventnor Radar website. This website was massively useful whilst researching the bunker, and the author gives a unique insight into the bunker from someone who was stationed there. I'd also recommend the book Cold War Secret Nuclear Bunkers by Nick McCamley. This book explains the rotor program in great detail and illustrates all the different types of bunkers used during this period. Due to the dangerous condition of the bunker, we've been careful not to leave any clues of how we managed to access the site. And for now, the bunker is once again safely sealed, but hopefully not forgotten.